is the first. He's the owner of mercy. He sent his messengers to all his creatures of the great dangers of worship.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله الملك الحق المبين، وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We begin in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All praise and glory belongs to Allah, Lord of the worlds. Indeed, Allah is deserving of the very best of thanks and the most beautiful of praises. And we testify that no one is worthy of our worship but Allah, alone without any partners, the true supreme king. And that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was his servant and his messenger, and the best of his creation, and the seal of his revelation, and the most beloved of the slaves of Allah to Allah, whom Allah Azza wa Jal sent to us as a mercy to all the worlds. May his finest blessings be upon that messenger Muhammad, and his family and his companions, and all those that follow in his footsteps and tread his path. May Allah Azza wa Jal include us among such lofty company. Allahumma ameen. Welcome back to the Prince of Piety, lessons from the story of Musa alayhi salam as told by Surah Al-Qasas. And we had begun in the previous episode the discussion on the verse wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us of how his perfect plan came full circle with the return of Musa alayhi salam to his mother. فَرَدَدْنَاهُ إِلَىٰ أُمِّهِ كَيْ تَقَرَّ عَيْنُهَا وَلَا تَحْزَنَ وَلِتَعْلَمَ أَنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. So we returned him to his mother so that her eyes may be comforted, and so that she would not grieve, and so that she would know that the promise of Allah is true, whereas most people do not. And we said of the very important lessons of this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala returned Musa alayhi salam to her so that she would know that the promise of Allah is true. That's the most important fruit, because when Allah grants you certainty through an ordeal, this is greater than whatever you missed out on in that ordeal, even if you don't get to see the happy ending here in this world. Because this world, in reality, it's a test. So seeing the result of that test is not necessarily a part of this world, though Allah Azza wa Jal may show it to you at times. And this is a lesson we saved for this episode. May show it for you at times to keep you going. If you consider the return of Musa alayhi salam to his mother anything short of a miracle, then you have quite a load of evidence to bring forth. You have to really think about it. This is nothing short of a miracle. A child being picked up at the hands of the ruthless murderers of children and brought to Fir'aun himself in that year when they killed all the male children. And then he is saved and brought back to the very door of his mother and raised with her. This is nothing short of something that we would consider normally impossible, a miracle. And we believe in Islam that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permits for miracles to happen. We call them karamat, if you will, that he honors certain people with such miracles. But the key here, though, is why? Why does Allah azza wa jal permit them? That same end that we spoke about before, so that we would know that the promise of Allah is true. You see, a miracle in and of itself happening to a non-prophet, we believe that this could happen, something extraordinary. But this is a gift to a person that he has to pay the tax for and pay the gratefulness for, right? A gift to a person to increase them in iman, right? That's what Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah in his book, Al-Furqan bayna awliya' ar-Rahman wa awliya' ash-Shaytan. The Furqan, meaning the differentiator between the allies of Allah and the allies of Shaytan. Basically, he says that a miracle is granted to a person as a gift from Allah and also as a test, because this world is all about tests. He says, and that's why, number one, we see more miracles with the later generations, the tabi'een, the second generation after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, than we see with the companions, the sahaba. He said, why is that? He said, because the point of a miracle, and this is absolutely brilliant, is to increase you in your yaqeen, increase you in your iman, and the tabi'een, the second generation, needed that more than the sahaba, and thus there was more prevalent in the latter than in the former. He says the second issue is that it was given to you as a gift so that you may increase in iman and as a test. A test, will you use it as a means to come closer to Allah, or will you be deluded by it? Because it's still a test. So even something happens to you miraculous, something extraordinary, this does not mean that you are virtuous down the line until the very end. This does not mean that you will be upon the path until it delivers you to Jannah. And that is why our early scholars would not consider someone righteous due to their knowledge based on a miracle happening to them. Because whereas the later generations from their ignorance, he says, they assume that this to be the case. Al-Shafi'i rahimahullah used to say, if I were to see someone يمشي على الماء, walking upon water, ويطير في الهواء, and flying in the air, I will not give my verdict regarding him. I would not say he's a good person until first I check where he is from the Quran and from the Sunnah. He says, because if he's on the Quran and Sunnah, I say Allah aided him with this to increase him in Iman, increase others in Iman. I say, but if he's not on the Quran and Sunnah, then I know he would not have those abilities except how? Except by first selling his soul to Shaytan. And thus it's a test. This power, if you will, or this miraculous event that may occur in a person's life, it is not a certification of virtuosity. It does not mean this person is a saint and a wali automatically. Definitely not the case. Allah does it and grants it to people to increase them in Iman. And if you hold on to Iman amidst all the oppositions, then that is the greatest gift. As Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says, وَأَعْظَمُ كَرَامَ لُزُومُ الْإِسْتِقَامَةِ. And of all these miracles, these gifts that Allah grants someone, the greatest of them is for you to actually remain steadfast the day that you breathe your last. So this gift was granted to her so that she may not grieve, and so that more importantly, she may know that the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is true, whereas most people do not. And of course, this also shows you the very unique way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects his slaves. Because he was returned to his mother, that doesn't mean everything returned to normal. No, this return to his mother was not like his initial stay with his mother. Because had she kept the child the first time around, she would never have been able to be comforted with that child. She would have lived with the constant fear that the soldiers would kick the door down at any moment and take that child from her. But Allah sent that child away from her into the hands of Fir'aun and brought him back, brought Fir'aun or his representatives to her door. And they are the ones who brought her child. Therefore, there is no fear any longer. Her eyes can be comforted with that child now. And it's not just that. They brought her child, so that she may care for him, and they paid her to do so. Look at how brilliant the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes into effect, but he only shows it to those that have Iman, and shows it at times only after a while, or else where is the trial? Where is the test then? They brought Musa alayhi salam to her. And it's mentioned that they gave her loads of money, and they gave her silk, and they used to put a stipend for her, a pay, an income for her every single month. And Musa alayhi salam was raised as the adopted son of Fir'aun. And at the same time, his mother, without anyone knowing, became his what? His mother through nursing. And he came to know from her more than just the nutrition of his body. And this is of the reasons why Allah sent him back to her, so he may suckle from her. He may take in Iman, more important than the milk, so that he may be raised a believer. And indeed, he began to mature, alayhi salam, into an extraordinary individual. Allah has said in his Quran, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهِ فَبِهُدَاهُ مُقْتَدِهِ. These are those whom Allah has guided, so seek an example in their guidance. They'll say, but I can never be as guided as the Prophet. You may not be as privileged as the Prophet, nor as guided as the Prophet, but that's beyond your capacity to begin with, so Allah will not ask you of it. But still, if you have the same qualities as the Prophets, even if it be a lesser degree, then you will have the same rewards as the Prophets, even if it be a lesser degree. And what was the reward mentioned in this ayah? Authority and knowledge. Likewise, there is authority and knowledge for every single person who is of the Muhsineen, not just Musa alayhi salam. And thus we reward the Muhsineen. This is similar to what? To the story of Yunus alayhi salam and so many others. Yunus alayhi salam was thrown into the belly of the whale. And then what happened? He called out to Allah Azza wa Jal in the darkness, La ilaha illa anta, subhanaka, inni kuntu min al-zalimin. None is worthy of worship but you. Glorified you are, I was of the wrongdoers. The next verse says, وَعَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِّ. So we rescued him from the difficulties, from his distress. وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And likewise, in the same manner, we rescue the believers. So it was that quality of Iman, which is the common denominator between us and the Prophets, that was a reason for his rescue. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam re-established this point in the authentic hadith. And he confirmed it by saying this very dua, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin, which Yunus alayhi salam made. He says no Muslim, no believer calls upon Allah using this except that he will be responded to. Allah Azza wa Jal will accept his dua. So we granted him knowledge and we granted him authority. Mujahid rahimahullah is of the scholars of the view that granted him authority means when he reached full strength, he became a prophet at this point. Because the scholars differ, did Musa alayhi salam become a prophet before he left Egypt or after? They all agree that by the time the famous incident happened, when Allah Azza wa Jal spoke to him from the tree, he was a prophet. But they differ as to whether he was a prophet before that or not. Some say we granted him authority and knowledge. Authority here means prophethood. But regardless, inshallah, whether it was prophethood or a lesser degree of authority, he was the leader of his people at that time. There is still a lesson to be learned from that. After the break, inshallah, we continue. Stay with us.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is your brother in Islam, Mamdouh Muhammad. You're watching Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth? And who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch Truth Prevail and Lies Perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik. Every Sunday to Friday at 9 p.m. and repeat telecast at 7:30 a.m. India on Peace TV. Invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching and argue with them in ways that are best and most gracious.
Allah has not asked us to make people Muslim.
Invite, offer, share.
Allah has asked us to invite people to Islam.
Be a part of the special mission for humankind.
Dawah is really an art. We need to refocus on the importance of Dawah. And this is about time the Ummah woke up.
In this unique workshop with Abdul Rahim Green.
We can't force anyone to be Muslim. What if we, as an ummah, could once again take up the duty and obligation of da'wah?
Learn how to aptly deliver Allah's message of Islam to people around the world in Da'wah. Every Sunday, Tuesday and Thursday at 11:30 p.m. and repeat telecast at 6 a.m. India on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walahu wa ba'd. Welcome back. We begin in the name of Allah. All praise and glory belongs to Allah. May His finest peace and blessings be upon His Messenger Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah, and His family and His companions and all those loyal to Him. Before the break, we said that Allah Azza wa Jal granted Musa alayhi salam hukman wa ilma, authority and knowledge, because he was of the muhsineen. So first of all, why was he given authority and knowledge in particular? And what is the relationship between authority and knowledge? Musa alayhi salam was being prepared by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to liberate Banu Israel from the tyranny of Fir'aun, this dictator. And there is no more necessary quality to a leader than knowledge. And knowledge in and of itself is power, it is authority, but for those that deal with it correctly. It is power and it is authority because, as the early Muslims used to say, that the kings rule the people and the scholars rule the kings, because they represent who? They represent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's religion upon the earth. So the truest knowledge, and consider this, because Egypt at that time is considered an amazing civilization, very advanced if you will. Egypt is considered the place of the pyramids, where people considered a stabilized government so stabilized in its early ages, thus we have it on our dollar and the likes. And then at the same time, he says, but we grant him knowledge, meaning to be superior to the Egyptians of his time, to be the leader of everyone, and to be superior to Fir'aun himself. Why? Because true knowledge is not knowledge of what? Of this worldly life. True knowledge is the ability to know Allah and to be qualified to deliver that knowledge of Allah to their creation so that they are not subjugated by others, thinking that others are their gods or thinking others can know better than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In certain ayat in the Quran, you read that Allah Azza wa Jalla told us how Fir'aun was able to subjugate. Just as every dictator is able to subjugate and oppress his nations, how? He says, فَاسْتَخَفَّ قَوْمَهُ فَأَطَاعُوا. Fir'aun bluffed his people and so they obeyed him. Because what? He bluffed them, he belittled their minds. He kept telling them one thing and they would accept it. In that case, there's more. And then he said, okay, in that case, I am your God. So Musa alayhi salam brought to them the clarity of both worlds, that your God in this world and the next, the master of the universe is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and his religion is the following. So Musa alayhi salam was given authority and knowledge so that he could lead Banu Israel with that. And then he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, and thus we give the muhsineen. And this is because he qualified for it, because we give it to the people of ihsan. What is ihsan? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam defined to us ihsan in two different ways. One way is the hadith of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, Sahih Muslim, wherein he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the man that was questioning, that they later found out was Jibreel alayhi salam, he said, ihsan an ta'bud Allah ka'annaka tarah, fa'in lam takun tarahu fa'innahu yarah. To worship Allah as though you see him, and if you don't see him, then he sees you. And if you realize you can't see him, then at least you know that he sees you. So that's one definition of ihsan. Ihsan is to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to that heightened state and degree of vigilance. It's as if you are staring at him, Azza wa Jal, and you are staring at him with your heart. You see Allah Azza wa Jal with your heart. As Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhum used to say, when a man, Urwa ibn Zubayr, came to speak to him about his daughter's hand in marriage while he was at the Kaaba, he refused to speak to him. And then later he said, how could I speak to you when we're making tawaf and we're imagining Allah right in front of us? This is that height of worship, to recognize Allah above all else. The second definition of ihsan is the hadith wherein the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى كَتَبَ الْإِحْسَانَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Indeed, Allah has written ihsan, meaning made an obligation in all matters. In the end of the hadith says, even to the degree of when you slaughter an animal, فَلْيُحْسِنِ الْقِتْلَ. Let the person show ihsan, show excellence in the way he kills, and فَلْيُحْسِنِ الذِّبْحَ. And let him show excellence the way that he slaughters, وَلْيُحِدَّ أَحَدُكُمْ شَفْرَتَهُ وَلْيُرِحْ ذَبِحَتَهُ. And let a person sharpen his blade and put the animal to rest. So this is another type of ihsan by the meaning of what? Kindness to the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ihsan is two things. Ihsan is to be fully recognizing of Allah, safeguarding his rights, and to be kind to his creation, you safeguard the rights of the creation. So when a person has these two qualities, thus we give the people of ihsan knowledge and authority. See, when a person is recognizing Allah and applies his knowledge, right, with regards to Allah, and he applies his knowledge with regards to the creation, and he safeguards the rights of the creation, Allah teaches him more. And Allah begins to teach him that which he did not know when he acted upon that which he knew. And the opposite is also true. It's a very interesting relationship between ihsan and between knowledge. When a person is not recognizing Allah, and he is not giving the rights of the creation, and his knowledge is lip service, it is but oration, it is lecturing, he becomes blind to the things that he once knew. You see, that knowledge that you have, it could be right in front of you. You benefit from it, you're always reminded about it. Or it could be right behind you, on your back, weighing you down, a burden against you. As he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَالْقُرْآنُ حُجَّةٌ لَكَ أَوْ عَلَيْكَ. The Qur'an is an evidence for you or against you. And that's why he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاةِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُ أَسْفَارًا. The example of those that took the Torah, the knowledge of the Torah, but it was as if they did not take it. I mean, they didn't act upon it, right? They ignored that knowledge. It's like the example of a donkey carrying a library, meaning he's carrying books to the world. He's a delivery service. He's carrying books to the world while it's just tiring him. He's not benefiting anything from it because he's a donkey. So he carries it. Allah has how awful an example it is to someone that does not recognize Allah through his knowledge. does not recognize the rights of the creation because of the knowledge. A person has to be careful. There will be no leadership without knowledge. And there will be no knowledge without ihsan. Many a times, of the reasons why, though this is not the only reason, the scholars have not taken their rightful place in this ummah, is because many a times, the knowledge that we gain of deen, and I ask Allah to protect us from being guilty of what we're saying now, our knowledge of deen is used almost like the knowledge that a lawyer has with regards to law books, that he uses it to get his client out. He uses it when it gets him something beneficial. He uses it when it's in his best interest. He uses the laws and studies them to a T to loophole around them when it serves him. Likewise, when a person uses the deen with his best interest and ignores the deen when it's not, this is not ihsan, it's not someone recognizing Allah and someone recognizing the rights that others may have as well that he knows from the religion of Allah. So when a person treats his knowledge the way the lawyer treats his law books, that is not ihsan, and he becomes burdened by that knowledge and thus does not become a leader the way that Musa alayhi salam was a leader. Allah granted him authority and knowledge, and you'd think knowledge is enough, but not everyone that has knowledge will be given a position of authority. He will have true authority, meaning in the hearts of the slaves, because he is of the people of Ihsan. May Allah Azza wa Jal make us and you of them. So this is of the greatest lessons we must take from this ayah. When he reached full strength, Allah is now maturing Musa alayhi salam and developing him under his eye. وَلِتُصْنَعْ عَلَىٰ عَيْنِي And I fashioned you under my eye. And he granted him authority and knowledge, and thus do we grant to all the people of Ihsan. This is all setting the stage for something very great, which is the culmination most likely of these episodes that we'll have time for in this season of episodes at least, and that is him actually becoming one of the greatest messengers ever. And Allah Azza wa Jal, just to summarize now, because we're about to move into another phase of his life, and that is the phase of a very enduring trial after trial after trial, a successive chain of tribulations, and as they say, when they don't break you, they make you stronger. So he had strength and he had maturity, but Allah Azza wa Jalla is going to send him a difficulty to increase him in strength. And then he's going to be sent out of Egypt in exile to be increased in maturity and become the shepherd of sheep to mature even further and acquire more patience. So look at how Allah Azza wa Jalla sets up for Musa alayhi salam the most perfect life. For he is the best guardian, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, he returned him to his mother. Just as a quick review, and we begin the next phase in the next episode, inshallah. We returned him to his mother at a time when she could enjoy him. We discussed this meaning already. She would not have been able to enjoy him before. This is just like how Allah Azza wa Jal sets up the prophethood of who? Of Yusuf alayhi salam. His father couldn't protect him from the brothers that were conspiring against him. So Allah sent him away. He went into the well, and then he came out. Then he was thrown into prison, far away from his father. And then it came full circle when he was matured. Allah was developing him. And Ya'qub alayhi salam knew that. And that's why you read in the ayat that when he finds out about his son being pulled away from him, he said, فَاللَّهُ خَيْرٌ حَافِظًا Allah is the best guardian. I'm the parent. I'm considered a guardian. Allah is the best guardian. وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحِيمِينَ And he's the most merciful. And the other ayah, Ya'qub alayhi salam, devastated about being far from his son, but he said what? وَأَعْلَمُ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ But I know about Allah which you don't know. This is the reason why I'm going back and reviewing. We must come to know and be satisfied and reassured that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works, as some say, in mysterious ways. Allah works in subtle, beautiful ways, as he tells us in the Quran. He begins little by little, returning him to his mother. Gradually, she's comforted and she feeds him iman, and he develops and he matures and he is granted knowledge and authority. And he is one of the muhsineen, those that recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and recognize the rights of the creation. And you will see all of that, inshallah azza wa jal, come into effect as the story progresses. It will unravel before our very eyes as Musa alayhi salam moves into this next scene, mentioned in the next verse, wherein he is confronted with a fight scene. And he does something that he was regretful of doing. But even though that mistake that he made was another way that Allah Azza wa Jal destined that he be taught, and that Allah Azza wa Jal mature him even further, when he go on his own now, and he begin to see for himself and notice the care of Allah and cling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, moving away from his mother. This is now, once again, a new phase why he's being disconnected. The same way that our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was disconnected from one person after another. He was disconnected from his father without ever seeing him. And then his mother died very early. and then he was taken by his grandfather Abdul Muttalib and he had died. And then we move on further where to his uncle Abu Talib, and soon, slowly but surely, his lifespan expires and he dies. He finds repose in Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha and comfort and support from her, and then she dies. This is so that his heart will not cling to anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will climb even after being of the people of Ihsan, he will climb in Ihsan. Even after recognizing Allah, he will recognize Allah even more. And as the scholars say, this is the epitome of Iman. When a person gets to a level where they see the world around them as nothing but the effects of Allah. Allah is the effector, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That were it not, it would not have happened. Were it not for Allah, it would not have happened. So he sees his whole world around him as a means to come closer to Allah and to ascend the ladder of servitude to Allah as Musa alayhi salam did. And that, consider that a preamble, if you will, to this next phase in his life when the strings get tied one by one and he starts heading into another beautiful direction in this amazing story. We hope you'll be with us inshallah in the following episodes. Sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
He created the universe. To him belong the heavens and the earth. The ever living, he is the first. He's the